Invite us to your feast, Lord, and we come to sing your praise, to proclaim your death and rising, and to share this meal of love. Lord, we come to you and we sing your praise as we listen to your word. Soon the bread we bring and the wine we pour will become your flesh and blood. You invite us to your feast, Lord, and we come to sing your praise, to proclaim your death and rising, and to share this meal of love. Be not mindful, Lord, of our sinfulness, do not judge us for our faults. Be compassionate, show your tenderness to the humble, contrite heart. You invite us to your feast, Lord, and we come to sing your praise, to proclaim your death and rising, and to share this meal of love.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Hearty welcome to you, my sisters and brothers, on this the 28th Sunday of the liturgical year. We continue hearing Jesus' parables as we approach the end of the liturgical year sometime next month. We pray for all of you. We join as one family. I was saying yesterday, we've got people from all over the world, and I was happy even from China. I got a letter saying we are participating in the Mass. We pray for China. We pray for all the countries in the world, for the leaders, for your leaders, that they guide the countries as God wants, that they bring us all closer to the kingdom of God, where all are one family, where justice, peace, truth prevails. Let's begin this Eucharistic sacrifice, putting ourselves in God's presence and asking His forgiveness for our sins. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have grievously sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let's all together now praise God in the words of the Gloria.
Glory to God, glory to God. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace on earth, peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, Heavenly King. O God, Almighty Father, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest,
and honor, peace on earth, peace to people of good will. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand, the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace on earth, peace to people of good will. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace on earth, peace to people of good will. Amen.
Let us pray. May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out your good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Kindly sit for the readings.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces and the reproach of his people. He will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord, we have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation, for the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our response shall be,
in the Lord's own house shall I dwell, forever and ever.
Kindly repeat.
In the Lord's own house shall I dwell, forever and ever. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures
waters he leads me, to revive my drooping spirit. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever. He guides me along the right path. He is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me comfort. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever. You have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you anointed with oil, my cup is overflowing. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever. Surely goodness and kindness shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever.
A reading from the letter of Saint Paul to the Philippians. Brethren, I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Yet it was kind of you to share my trouble, and my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that time, again Jesus spoke to the chief priests and elders of the people in parables, saying, The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. And he sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants saying, "Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen, my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast." But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants and treated them shamefully and killed them. The king was angry and sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burnt their city. Then he said to the servants, "The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads, invite to the wedding feast as many as you find." And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding feast was filled with guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there a man who had no wedding garment. He said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. And the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot, cast him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear sisters and brothers, my dear friends, families, religious sisters in a particular way, today's gospel passage continues Jesus' teaching of the parables. This passage, this incident is narrated in the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew 22, but it's also found in the Gospel of Luke. And Mark, Gospel of Mark, these three synoptics go together, are connected in the sense Mark was the origin. Matthew, when he wrote Gospel, Mark was already written before, and he had that before him. He knew what was said in Mark. From Mark, we can make out exactly more or less, because he was accurate about the dates, etc., we can make out when this incident happened. When did Jesus speak this parable? Comparing the three Gospels and the incident and the other sections, we can conclude that this happened on Tuesday in Holy Week. On Palm Sunday, Jesus entered Jerusalem to the hosannas of the people. He went to Bethany for the night. Early next morning he came. When he came, he found all this commerce going on in the temple, and he was upset. "You've made my father's house a house of thieves." And he upset the money changers' tables and people who were selling things in the temple. They had made it, they desecrated it by doing all these things in the temple, house of God. And that was on Monday. So naturally, on the chief priests and they were probably getting a commission from all this commerce going on in the Jerusalem temple, and so they were upset. And so Jesus goes back and comes early next morning on Tuesday once again, and into the temple. It's whole week he's come over there. He's come for the Passover on Good Friday. And then naturally he's confronted. Yesterday they told him, "By whose authority you're doing all this?" And he if you remember, put a counter question to them and told them, Jesus knew what was in their minds. They were trying to trap him. And he said, by whose authority did John preach? And then Jesus began giving them these parables. So this was on Tuesday of Holy Week. Last Sunday, we had the parable of the tenants who were not giving the produce back. And you know what? They were rude, beat up those people who came to take the rent, even killed some. When he sent his son, the son was killed. That's the parable. And today again, you can sense, I mentioned this timeline, because you can sense a sense of urgency in Jesus. He's giving the same message strongly. Every parable, my sisters and brothers, is Jesus gives a life situation and we draw lessons from it. There have been a lot of scripture scholars who have written books and volumes on just the principle of the parable, the style of Jesus. Now he gives, last Sunday's parable was said just before this parable, within hours or within perhaps an hour of each other. And so he's getting the same message. There he had said, those people who had owed the father so much, the landlord so much, were not paying. And when the son came to collect the rent, they killed him. And now here again, this today's parable, again a story, not a real incident, a story which Jesus narrates, for us to draw a lesson. And we ask ourselves on this Sunday, what is the lesson that we want, what Jesus wants to give us? What do we get from this for us today? Here again, it's a strange incident, and I want to tell you that I think, find it very difficult to fully understand. It's one of the difficult parables to really, what is Jesus trying to say? It just seems so unusual. That the king gives a feast. Must have been a very big occasion, this is a story. And his sons, because of his son's wedding. And then afterwards, the people are not interested. Some people give excuses. This is unusual, doesn't happen. If the king gives an invitation for his son's wedding, it's a big occasion. It's his privilege to be invited. People would feel, well, I'm honored, I've been chosen. And the custom was, sisters and brothers, that time, when they gave invitations, big people gave invitations for these big functions, they would invite them, wouldn't tell them what time or what day, because they've got to prepare, but they were told to keep themselves ready. And generally, very often, the king had also given them the wedding garment. They had it in their robes. That's why that last incident. Now, so they did not know when, but these people, indifferent, not coming, not interested. Some give excuses. I was reading a sermon by one of the preachers in America, and he says about excuses, an excuse has got the outer skin of a reason with a lie inside. So outer covering means seem reasonable, but inside is a lie. You don't tell the truth. An excuse means, so it happens to all of us. Somebody invites you for something, just take the similar example, and you don't want to go because of the company or because of some other reason, your past. And then you say, really, I would like to come, but I've got something else. Or my daughter's exam is on the same day, or I've got to go for something else. It's a very reasonable thing, but inside is a lie. That's what. So they were giving all sorts of reasons to avoid coming. Unusual to refuse. Unusual also the king's reaction when he comes and he sends his troops because they beat up. No one beats up when people come with an invitation. You don't beat them up with the one carrying the. It's most unusual. So really, I said that's difficult to understand. And then also the king's reaction different when they beat him. He sends his troops and destroys their city. Now, that's normally not done. But Jesus gives us a story for us to draw a lesson. And then he says, call everybody from this roadside, good and bad. And so they all come. That's also normally not done. And then when somebody's got not the proper garment, again says throw him out and into the outside. Also normally not done. So very unusual. How do we, what is the message Jesus wants to give us? What we can get, this is an extraordinary situation. An extraordinary wedding, extraordinary king, extraordinary guests. Sisters and brothers, at that time, everybody was waiting for the messianic feast, messianic banquet. That was, and this messianic banquet idea came from what we read in the first reading. Isaiah speaks of the messianic banquet on the mountain, praising God. This, incidentally, the first time in the Old Testament, there's a very clear indication of an eternal life, life after death. Because it says, I'm offering a sacrifice on this mountain, and the Lord will take away the veil that covered everybody, the veil of death, the veil of sadness. So again, an indication this prophet gives to us of eternal life. But I was saying, what Jesus expects is for us to say yes to the invitation. This is an invitation which the Lord gives to the kingdom of God, to his banquet, to become his disciple. The message is when he invites us, first some chosen people, then more, again gives an indication, refers it to give you the what scripture callers tell us, first the Jews were invited, then all others were invited. And they are, when the son is actually, they said he killed the prophets, the ones prophets were killed, because the messengers were killed. So all refers to the Old Testament. Jesus invites us and expects from us a yes. And therefore, the first question for us to ask is, as we are invite each one of us, sisters and brothers, we've been hearing the Gospels every day or every Sunday. We've been praying at home every so often, receiving the sacraments, thinking about God. And we examine ourselves, what is it that the Lord invites me to? How does he invite me to a greater intimacy with him, a greater closeness with him, a relationship with him, of to be his disciple, to be his missionary disciple, as Pope Francis keeps on telling us. The Lord invites us to become one family. Pope Francis last Sunday released an encyclical, Fratelli Tutti, on brotherhood and social friendship, of how the whole world should become one family. Invites us to be instruments in making the world one family. That's the continuous invitation. But you know, we, like the people over here who are punished finally, are busy, he says, going to the farm, tending the house, things which are unimportant. The one thing important for eternal life, which is referred to in the first reading from Isaiah, is following Jesus. The second thing is, second message from this passage, this difficult passage, is everybody was invited, but the man did not have the wedding garment, and therefore he was thrown out. So it's not just saying yes to God's invitation, but also having the wedding garment. You must be dressed for the occasion. To give you again why they understood, very often the king would, they would have robes given by the king for these big occasions. So really, people knew what they had to wear. And this man did not bother about it, or he came in a hurry, and so he did not have. But then the wedding garment which we have to have when we go to Jesus, the wedding garment is a life of grace. The wedding garment is a life of discipleship. Jesus taught us repeatedly, and we get this, it comes again and again in the gospel, the whole law and the prophets are summarized in this: love God and love your neighbor as yourself. This is the wedding garment that we must have. If we have this, then we are invited for the feast, the eternal feast, eternal life, heaven. sisters and brothers, let's, I invite you to read the gospel again. See what Jesus invites you to. See how often we have postponed saying yes to him. How often we have pretended we haven't heard him. So all of us, each one of us is invited. If you go deeper and deeper, and I go deeper and deeper, we'll find every now and then, yes, we heard the Lord's voice, but we pretended we didn't hear it. And again, important that we prepare ourselves for this eternal feast by our lives of charity, of love, of service. Thus, we will be truly disciples of Jesus. God bless each one of you. Sisters and brothers, let us now respond to God's teachings in the gospel by saying, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. My brothers and sisters, in today's gospel, we read how those invited to dine with the king rejected his invitation. Loving Father, you invited us to dine and be nourished with the food of life, which is the Eucharist. Encouraged by your invitation to come to your table, we confidently make our prayers to you.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, Archbishop Cardinal Oswald, Gracious, the bishops of India, that continuously strengthened by the Eucharist, they may lead the Church in realizing the Kingdom of God. Our response,
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all civil authorities that they work in a coordinated manner to halt the spread of the coronavirus. Our response,
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the vulnerable in our society, particularly the sick and the elderly, who continue to experience fear, loneliness, and isolation during this pandemic crisis. We pray that they receive the care, support, and encouragement which they need to protect their health at this difficult period. Our response,
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all in our country, that they show consideration and care for themselves and for others, and abide strictly by the guidelines which our governments and healthcare professionals recommend to control the contagious COVID-19 virus at this time. Our response,
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that each parish of our diocese may be a living sign of the presence of Christ in the world. We also pray for vocations to the priesthood, especially for our diocese, that they may be adequate workers in the vineyard to serve all our parishes and communities. Our response,
Lord, hear our prayer.
We bow our heads and remember in silence our own personal intentions and the intentions of those who have asked for our prayers. our response.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our loving Father, strengthen our awareness and commitment to the mission that we have inherited through your gift of baptism. May we hear your word, understand it, and follow it. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread which we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine which we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that your sacrifice and mine may be acceptable to God, our Father in heaven.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness may pass over to the glory of heaven. Make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state. By his suffering, he cancelled out our sins. By rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life. By ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. So with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise. Without end we acclaim.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dew fall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who've died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who've pleased you throughout the ages, we merit to be coerced into life, we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us be with confidence to the Father in the words Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer you the sign of peace. Christ's peace be with you. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
We now make our spiritual communion with the Lord. O Lord Jesus, since I cannot now receive you in your sacramental presence, I beg you to come spiritually into my soul, to enrich me with your holy grace, and make me truly your own forever. O Jesus, living in Mary, come and live in me, in the spirit of your holiness, in the fullness of your power, in the communion of your mysteries, in the perfection of your ways. O divine guest, give to my soul a strong, lively faith, an unbounded trust, perfect humility, an abiding sorrow for my sins, a total abandonment to your divine will, and a perfect loving union with you in mind and heart. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine. Lord Jesus, thank you for the blessings and graces you have given me through this spiritual communion.
Let us pray. We entreat your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, you may make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Once again, thank you. Have a lovely Sunday, lovely week ahead. And look forward to see some of you this evening at the question and answer session of the Archdiocese. I want to also announce that I think today is the International Day of the Girl Child. We ourselves celebrated it on the 8th of September. But happy feast to all the girl children in the different homes, and treat them a little special today. I want to announce that next Sunday, we've been promoting the Archdiocese of Bombay, the effort to have lots of people join civil services, armed forces, etc. And last few years we've been having meetings with students and trying to get back to as much as normal as we can. We'll continue this effort, and next Sunday we'll have a webinar. We'll get Commodore Stanley de Cunha to address us, and I don't have the link right now, but keep in mind that next Sunday, I'm not sure honestly whether they are planning it in the morning or the evening, but keep your Sunday, probably the morning, that's where they normally have the meetings. I'll let you have the link. Keep it a couple of hours on next Sunday free for that. God bless you. Have a lovely Sunday, lovely week, and keep well. God bless.
We pray now for relief from the coronavirus. Almighty and merciful God, who show your love to all creation everywhere, hear graciously the prayers we make for all those affected by the coronavirus in various parts of the world. We come before you asking for a quick control of the outbreak, for a healing of those affected, for the victims and their families. We pray for the doctors doing research that an effective vaccine to combat the sickness is speedily found. We pray for the government and health authorities that they take appropriate steps for the good of the people. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hungry, thirsty, Lord, we came, but joy is now we leave. Nourished by the bread of life, renewed.
good and ready to serve. Together we have shared this meal, the bread of unity. Help us, Lord, to build a world where love and charity abide. Hungry, thirsty, Lord, we came, but joy is now we leave. Nourished by the bread of life, renewed and ready to serve. You told us, Lord, to be the light that shines for all to see. Send your Spirit in our hearts to keep the fire of love ablaze. Hungry, thirsty, Lord, we came, but joy is now we leave. Nourished by the bread of life, renewed and ready to serve.